What's up, guys? Welcome back. I have a video request from a new friend, Samuel Greene. He's taking lessons with an online friend of mine, Chris Burnett. See, for Chris Burnett's actually a really nice guy. I know him from the Tai Chi forums, and I think he's one of the, emblematic of what a good teacher should look like. And I'm not saying that because I think he's the best fighter or his technique's the best. It's because no one cares how much you know until you know how much you care. And very few other teachers I've seen online who I've watched over the years who continually are studying and maintaining their studentship. And in my opinion, in order to be a good teacher, it was always remaining students. So, I'm honored that someone, a teacher like that, came to me to ask for, any advice. So, Chris, much love to you guys, everybody from the Tai Chi forums and Facebook, much respect. Samuel had a couple of questions. And I'm going to do my best. Unfortunately, because I don't have a partner, I won't be able to demonstrate some things today. The first question he had asked was how to use a kai or pluck. Okay? So, some people will say, and this is a very big truth. You have the four, you have eight energies, right? And it's basically, look at the chaos wheel, okay? And you have your four main directions and your four off angle directions. Most people will use, Chale Dokal as a way to compensate for the lack in the four energies. While that is a good foundation, I don't believe that the case. I think that each thing is a universe unto itself. At the same time, they do interact. Pluck can be used so many different ways, okay? And I don't think there is a proper way, okay? It's something that you feel out. When I apply pluck, generally is a wrestling thing. Pluck is, to me, an abrupt drawing in. Like you want to think like you're pulling a flower off of something, or you're pulling a piece of lint off of your clothes. That's the feeling I want to generate when I do chai, like the plucking energy. So what I tend to do is I add the energies combined together, meaning all in every shape. All energies are there. Pungu Jia Chai Lai Dokal is all in every shape, in every movement. There is a point where you will see there's rollback, there's press, there's seal, like the on seal. You'll have a position where you can do splitting, right? Like the split energy. You have the position where there's a pluck, because when I do split, there's an opportunity to pluck. So, when I do pluck, there's an opportunity to do shoulder or shoulder. I see it holistically where they're not separate. But I can understand for the beginner, intermediate, even low advanced level that you can't qualify it mentally because there's too much information. It's hard to distinguish. But try to grasp the concept. It's all together. So I tend to add pluck when I want to get the reaction of pluck. Right? So if I'm doing rollback, I can add that pluck energy and drag him up. It could be used many different ways. As a strike, you should think of it as tear. So, now people will argue about this. My personal opinion, going back to the roots, all of the animal energies have to be in the Tai Chi form originally. Okay, I know that it's snake and hawk. But there's repulse monkey, there's carry tiger, there's snake in it, there's mantis in it, there's all these, it's there. Sorry about the air conditioner. So it's there in everything, okay? So in the beginning, it's a good idea to say, okay, I'm gonna train this idea. But from my perspective, Tai Chi is one energy in one form. If I was gonna break it down, I would say, and I always say this, my style only has Peng and An. And everything else is a byproduct of those two energies interacting with each other. So I can't separate them. So it's difficult for me to say when you should use this or how. It's when the opportunity presents itself and you feel it in the flow. And that's only come through time, through touching people and experiencing that and allowing it to become a part of you internally. Because of motivation and response. I hope that makes sense. The next question was staying motivated. And this is a difficult concept because it comes down to your internal perception. I think the biggest mistake is that people tend to overtrain And I'm not saying that it's wrong. He said, I think he was, if I remember, I didn't write it down, but in the email, I think he was saying he trains like 12 hours a week and 90 minute sessions on his own, which I think is incredible and it's great. Now, depending on why you're training and, you know, how, your thing that'll motivate you will be different. When I was growing up, it was that if I didn't know how to fight, I wasn't going to make it home. I couldn't protect my family. I couldn't protect my friends. Like I try to explain to people, and I try not to take offense that you guys don't understand how violent my life was. You know, it was terrifyingly violent. I survived ritual abuse, gang wars, like terrifying things, you know, and then working, you know, in the field, I've seen horrible things. And it's difficult for me to express that. So my motivation as a kid was first, don't die. All right, that was my motivation. So, you know, and the second thing was to honor my family. Even though my family wasn't great to me, you know, there was still this honor that I wanted to, you know, to honor my ancestors, you know? And then as I got older, I wanted to honor my teacher, right? And, you know, to the people that, you know, be it my karate school, the gangs I was with, the crews I was with, the teams I was on, whoever it was, I felt that motivation for my brotherhoods, you know? But for me, the motivating factor was always an external threat. And that was for the beginning of most of my training life. You know, so I think also is the accepting that life is suffering. And you cannot progress without pressure, right? A diamond isn't made in the comfort of a living room, right? It's extreme pressure. It's terrifying pressure, you know? So that acceptance of eating bitter, right, is one of the things that helped me stay on path. Now, I think a major part of it is making it part of your, you know, your reptilian brain likes patterns, repetition. So when you do something so often, like for instance, there was so many years worth of karate I didn't want to go to, though, like I got, you know, but you did it because you had to, and you did it because that's what you do. It wasn't about being motivated, it was about this is what we're doing, we have to do it. It's a duty, it's like a contract, and I have to fulfill the contract because my honor is at stake. So it was a little different for me. But, you know, what motivates people is an individual thing. It's very difficult to share motivational factors. What I will say is that know when to not train. Know when to cut things back. It's more important, I found, like, you know, I was young, I was training hard. I think, you know, unless, like, it's more important to have very specific quality training. I'd rather see people training 10 minutes twice a day than 90 minutes every day if that 10 minutes is highly specific and very well organized, all right? That you're dealing with details and fine-tuning. You know, you should train as long as you feel good. Another thing is you don't want to train to the point where you can't train the next day. You know, you don't want to feel terribly sore. It's a mistake. This is what bad trainers do to sell product, because a young student or a new client, they feel that they don't feel hurt. They didn't feel like they did anything. So it's hard, you know, to express to your client or your student that you don't need to suffer to learn. You have to suffer, but not that badly, right? To progress properly. I'd rather have quality training at high volume than hand training that makes me feel like I did a lot, you know, because you're spinning the wheels and not getting anything done. So it's a very difficult thing for me to say this is the right way to motivate someone. You know, my teacher motivated us with a fucking stick. Okay, like it was with pain, with suffering. You know, so I don't know how to say that, but I think the main thing in my older was gratitude that I get to train every day. You know, I get to breathe. I'm allowed the time to go out and train again, you know, and to progress. And I think the most important thing is to only compare yourself to yourself yesterday. And that's why nobody in my class has ever kept up with me. Because while they're comparing themselves to me or the people, I didn't care what they were doing. You know, I used to use tape and quarters on the wall, and I would measure all my techniques so that they were geometrically perfect, right? Like, my teacher, when you do, like, a karate school, you see people go punch here, punch here, punch here, punch. No one's the same. And in our school, it was, you know, we had these, the floor was a wood floor, but it was the, you know those, like, 1 foot square, like, wood tiles you glue down? So the wood floor was like a grid, and we used that grid to keep everything on track. So for us, this is a correction. This. That's how fine the details were in my school. Okay? Like, you know, you were punching a target the size of a dime. You were kicking a target the size of a dime. You know, and it was all about making everything as perfect as possible. So I took that to an extreme. And that's all I cared about, was refining my techniques. That was my motivation, you know? Is I kept setting this goal to, how was I yesterday? Could I make it this much better? Can I fine-tune that thing? Can I? And that was the game to me that kept me motivated, I think, the most, was that there's nobody but me. You know what I mean? And once I started to see that, by only competing with myself, I was leaving people behind. And I started to see, wow, you know, my teacher was right when he said that this is how I have to do it. And that, I think, helped a lot. So that's the best I got. How to open your hips. Okay, this is a complicated situation because I'd have to do a movement assessment on the individual to tell you what's wrong with your hip. Okay, so you know, I'm also certified by FMS, so I did functional movement thing. And, you know, I was a very high level trainer, did post pre rehab. So it would be very difficult for me to say open the quad, right? Open the hip. What does that mean? I think there's a big misunderstanding about being relaxed and being loose and those, and what really is necessary for open. What does that mean? So I think more important is, yes, you know, obviously we can go over the basics. You need to know what foam rolling is. A big thing of Tai Chi people don't do, they don't stretch and they don't do prehab or rehab. So you need to understand what myofascial release techniques are, right? Trigger point compression type thing like that. So I would recommend that you look up trigger point therapy. Trigger point therapy and foam rollers and myofascial release techniques. That's the first thing I would say. You know, look at that. Look at, you know, how to release your quadricep, you know, the psoas, you know, iliopsoas and, you know, glute med, QL, things like that. Basically, the problem with hips is, you know, when you're constantly in the modern world sitting, muscles will tend to shape around the processes that you're going through in life. So if you're constantly sitting, your body will adapt to sitting. If you're a runner, you'll notice that the upper pec will die off. Like, you know, you can't, it's hard to be a runner and have a big upper chest. You know what I'm saying? Your body will go catabolic and dissolve things, or go anabolic and build things to help adapt to the situations and the stresses of your life. So you have to start by combating that, right? So I would first say is remove things first. Like, remove the items that you feel would be a hindrance to getting the hip open before trying to open the hip. So if you see you're in a repetitive pattern where you're constantly sitting, or I think I'm sorry, I don't remember because I've been answering so many emails today. I think he mentioned he was an herbalist, but let's say he was a massage therapist, for instance. Some massage therapists I wind up, you know, treating afterwards because they have upper cross syndrome, you know, all kinds of other pathologies because of their type of work and their posturing. You know, internal rotation of the wrist, you know, the shoulders are, you know, punching the ear, they have neck impingements and all kinds of weird stuff that happens from doing their job. And these are high level professionals who should know better and they don't. So it's very difficult. So I would say first, look over your daily life outside of Tai Chi and see how many things are hindering your basic movement. Now, as for stretching, I think you've got to be stretching, okay? The psoas, and psoas, they call it the psoas paradox. It's so difficult to relieve the psoas because of the way, how deep it is, how wide it is, how many muscles it crosses, the interactions in the myofascial system. It's very difficult to release that muscle. You know, psoas is basically, I want you to think of your quad. Think of it as one muscle, and it goes through your abs and attaches to your spine, the front, in a fan. Okay? Most of the hip problems are coming from that psoas muscle, the glute medius, quadratus lumborum. Okay? So it's these muscles here, the big culprit is usually the psoas. However, the psoas are so difficult to release. So I would say is go back to trigger point basics, you know, get a ball, put it right up your butt, learn how to release the glute medius, piriformis, learn how to release your quadricep, okay? And that will, you'll see immediate gains. If you learn how to properly foam roll, maybe I'll do a video on that, but properly foam rolling, you will see an immediate increase in mobility if you know how to do a foam roll properly and do a basic release technique. So look that up on YouTube, okay? Now there's basic stretches you can do. Now, let's just take your front stance, okay? Take a front stance. Can you see my feet? I'm gonna try to make this a little better. Okay. So, you're not gonna be able to see my head, but it's not really important right now. Get yourself into a front stance, and what I want you to do is make sure you leave the back leg straight, and you're gonna push your butt down and tuck your pelvis, and immediately you're gonna feel strain here. The knee doesn't have to be locked straight, by the way, okay? You want it to be straightened, but not locked, all right? This is a relaxed straight leg. And then you're gonna dip your pelvis down and wait until you feel pressure here. Once you feel that stretch, okay, you take the hand, bring it up, and just lean it over to the side. You can increase this by rotating the foot inward the wrong way, okay? And you'll feel it increases slightly. So you make a bad front stance, okay? You can increase that by slowly dropping down. You'll feel it go into your quad. You can see how it's releasing the hip because all of this is connected through the hip. The hip is just a bone set. You have, you know, the head of the femur, that's a tabulum. All it does is rotate like this. So it's really the muscles around the hip that are causing the hip problem. Unless you have a mechanical issue, you know, with the synovial fluids or things like that. If you have a mechanical lock, that's a different issue you can see a doctor for, okay? If you feel this bone's rubbing or you feel like weird stuff and clicking and you feel like there's a mechanical bone lock, that's something to be addressed by a doctor. However, if you feel just tension, this is something you can handle on your own, okay? So a very easy stretch, okay? Just push your butt down, okay? Feel that pressure, bring the hand up, slightly lean over. Hold that 10 to 30 seconds, do reps, okay? Bend the knee, do the same thing. Then you go all the way down to the floor, do the same thing. Okay, these are all variations of the same exercise, okay? Another decent one is you sit down and you just do that crab stretch, okay? Get this thing to open up here. That's really that simple. Obviously, other way, sitting down, stretch the butt. Okay, I hope that helps. Last, but not least, or maybe it is the least because it's the last, I don't know. He's asking what are the differences between Tai Chi and other martial arts. And I'm the worst guy to ask that because I'm a walking contradiction. As much of a tough guy asshole I present myself on the outside, on the inside I think completely opposite. I was always looking for the unifying theories of martial arts. I want to find how to bring things together. And if something wasn't, if you don't see a truth by practical consensus, it's not really normally useful. So I look for the similarities. You're gonna ask me what is the main differences between the karate style I did and Tai Chi. There are obvious differences, okay? The main difference is the walking step. Taekwondo is, you know, it has all the ranges, but people see it as a predominantly long range art because it's the northern legs. It's northern legs, southern fist, okay? So when you look at the traditional karate, like Shotokan, like I learned, you know, Tomokan, the stances are exactly squared up. Why? Because northern legs, southern fist styles are always square, right? Because you're dealing in swamp, land, marsh, fighting on boats and rivers, you know, tight spaces, so you didn't have the range, okay? So in Taekwondo, like when you're at far range, you have this split stance where you're sideways using your long range weapons, and then when you get to close range, you have what should look like when trying to be doing it properly. I know it sounds crazy, but it should look very similar to the untrained person. So the walking step, Tai Chi walking step is because you always want to maintain a root, right? Meaning your ground path, a closed kinetic chain. So the idea is this walking step leaves you, walking is a controlled fall. So the most steady controlled fall is the Tai Chi walking step when you're going heel to toe. The way that William C.C. Chen explains it is three nails, where you have a nail in the bottom of the heel, a nail in the ball, and a nail in the toe. I took that a step further 20 years ago, and I explained it as an electrical current. Well, this is your positive channel, this is your negative channel, this is your ground channel. So if you ever go back in time to the 80s when the three-prong outlets just came out, in America anyway, you would be able to break the bottom ground wing off, it would still work, right? If the two prongs were there. If I took one of the top two prongs, it won't work. This is how your feet work in martial arts. I can fight boxing, taekwondo, toe and ball. I cannot stand just on my heels. Okay? However, if I get all three down, I have a complete grounded circuit. It's very clean energy. So that's the difference. In taekwondo, we don't root until there's contact. So one of the things, the first lessons that you get in my style was the master stands and says, which one of my feet are on the ground right now? And I'm going to tell you, one of them's not. What we do is take a dollar bill, and he would put the dollar bill under your heels. And he would show, well, which one was on the ground, which one is rooted. And if someone hits us, we get hit, we can bounce. And then when I want to make contact, I just touch the floor with my heel, and that's when I get my Tai Chi full power, right? Is when that heel drops, okay? Tai Chi is a close range style only, and they don't have kicking. Another thing with the kicking, you don't want your heel on the ground because it'll torque your knee. So if I throw a side kick, right? It's gonna be toe, ball, heel kick. So heel then kick, okay? See what I'm saying? So chamber comes up, I go to the toe ball, and then after the pivot, I drop the heel, and then I launch the kick, okay? So that gives me a three-prong outlet grounded channel. That's when I connect back to Tai Chi footing, okay? If I was to do Taekwondo long-range northern-style kicks with the walking step, very likely you're gonna bust your knees up. So that's why they don't do that. So that's the difference. What other differences there are? Another difference in my opinion is Tai Chi originally was taught in a line, and there were strikes, and it was a hard style. So, in my honest opinion, when you do the Tai Chi as a square form, it looks the same. There's parts that look the same. When I go from here to here, it's very similar to an inside forearm block in Taekwondo. Right? It's just rounded because it says make the round straight and straight round. It's a way of hiding technique. Okay? So when you square your Tai Chi form, you start to see everything. Okay? Instead of doing, I'll just do a basic single lip, right? If I just do basic single lip, how everybody else does it, when you do it like that, you don't see the edges. So if I just do it, what do I have here? Knife hand strike, right? Knife hand, it shows you. All you have to do is make a right angle, okay? You call it preparation action phase. Same in the military, in the martial arts, you have a command of preparation, a command of action, right? Right? Preparation spoken, action is grunted, okay? Same thing with your chamber and action phase in fighting. So that's how I tend to look at it. The other thing is that in Taekwondo, there's a very limited amount of targets and techniques, meaning we are trained to smash a small target as much power as possible. You know what I mean? We do go force against force. Like, we don't have a problem with if you're kicking me, I'm gonna break your leg with my elbow. Because that's how the old style, it's not, I'm just gonna block you. If you ever see me sparring, you say I block my open hand, because if I block with the coat, it'll leave serious bumps on people. So we tend to do palm block, because these are friends you're training with. But, you know, that's one thing where we will meet force with force. That's a difference. However, the mechanical alignment, when I block that instant of impulse, the alignment internally should be the same. Power generation for breaking, the same way that, and this is a thing I've had discussions with people think that the karate punch is from the tricep, and it's not true, okay? There's two forms of punching. If you look at my knuckles, okay, the middle knuckle is the divider line. These two knuckles are trailing from the spiral line, oblique sling to the front, and these three are hitting from the spiral line through the back. So you have an anterior oblique sling and a posterior oblique sling. When they say power is like shooting a bow from an arrow, we open the sling, this stretches, and then it rebounds. The arm, the impulse that the arm is sending out is very little. This is a dead weight, same as Tai Chi. This is the 9-section whip, okay? We tighten up at the end, but the tension that I feel is actually in my delt, my pec, my abs, and my front leg, not my tricep. See? Now, remember that the tricep and the bicep work on radial supination, okay? So if I turn, you'll see that the tricep aids and the bicep aids in this rotation. So most of that they're seeing is an effect of rotating the wrist, but the power generation of step up deflect power you punch and Taekwondo reverse punch is exactly the same, the way I was taught, okay? People are gonna argue, I don't have to tell them, you know? This is my findings, and I've tested this in real life, I've hit a lot of people, and nobody was happy with me when I punched them. So, say what you will, this is what I got for you. We have dotting, stabbing with spear finger, same exact ways in Tai Chi. We have palm strikes in the higher levels. And this is, I'll leave you with this, the main difference that my master taught me is that the old karate was a hard, soft style, and Tai Chi is a soft, hard style. And what that was explained to me was that we start, because you have to, and Taekwondo is meant as a war art. You gotta get a lot of people to be able to kill people now. Your town's gonna be invaded. You have 6 weeks to 3 months to get people fight effective where they can actually take somebody out with their bare hands. You don't have time. So in the beginning stages, you learn very simple, direct, hard techniques that you know if I hit you, you're gonna have a bad day. Tai Chi was not made for you to fight today. Tai Chi was a master's art where you have to do it for years with the intent, like a surgeon, okay? Taekwondo was the other way, but at the highest level, it should be the same. So what I mean by that, if you see some Tai Chi forms, they have explosive and then relaxed. Not everything is this super soft Yang style bullshit, okay? So if you just look around, you're gonna see that there's, you have to power out. You can't do this and expect it to work. That's not how the emperor's bodyguards were doing Tai Chi, okay? That wouldn't work. And you tell me the emperor of China is gonna go and take some pussies who don't know how to fight? It doesn't make sense. So, it doesn't work, okay? So, one move in Taekwondo, give it a forward block, you have this kick, one, two, right? Now we'll do this. What is this? You have this same exact thing, okay? This is a form of press and rollback. And what is this? Golden cock stands on one leg. So as you progress in the higher levels, and Taekwondo becomes soft, and Tai Chi should become hard. All right, I hope that helps. Say hi to Chris from me, Sam, all right? And see you guys next time.